Hello, everybody. I'm Michael Boogaloo Shrimp Chambers, also known as Turbo from the movie Breakin' and Electric Boogaloo. And you're watching FaceTime with Todd Wharton. Oh, yeah.
Yo, what's up, yo? It's DJ Waffles. Yo, these two hip-hop dance legends want to battle me. You know I'm down, and they're about to feel my battle. And this next segment is called Challenge Accepted. What?
Here we go, on the run, don't know what we're running from.
We'll be right back with Michael Chambers and Lawrence B. Scott. Shut up!
Welcome back to the show, everyone. So my guest tonight is pretty much an iconic dancer. You know him as the character Turbo in the hit movies Breakin and Breakin 2 that took the world by storm. But you know what? Let's take a look at a clip.
Yes.
Please welcome to the show, my guy, Michael Chambers.
Good, but you gotta say it in New York. How you doing, hey? How you doing?
Hey, how you doing, Michael Chambers? Hey. What's going on out in LA? What's going on? Yeah, I love your energy, bro. I love your energy. So we're gonna go. I always tell people, let's jump right into the whole thing. Let's start from kind of what's going on right now. And then we'll backtrack a little. You're working on a new movie right now. I checked out the trailer called Life Moves, and it's with my girl Yo-Yo, Fearless. If you guys don't know that legendary female hip-hop lady with my man. I'm just playing with you guys. It's my man, Michael Chambers. But anyway, it's my dude for a long time. Michael, tell me about this movie, Life Moves. I think it's dope.
Well, I auditioned for Medea, but they said I was too short. Tyler Perry said, no, you're too short. So anyhow, what happened was me and the producer and the director were trying to figure out how can we convince my worldwide audience, fans of the movie Breakin' and hip hop elements, you know, and the whole dance culture, how can we convince people that I'm not living in the 80s, and I'm not walking around with a jerry curl, and I'm a man now. I went from the broom to the Michael Chambers. Mm-hmm. So he said, why don't you show your writing skill and your acting chops that you've learned along the way. And sure enough, we started writing and coming up with the idea of a new film. And this film is really, really a good film. And I have to say, it's not about dance. I'll whet your guys' appetites. But the good thing is it's a quality film. We try to think of South by Southwest, the film festivals, as we were conceiving the idea for the plot and the storyline. And with that in mind, we wanted critics to look at it like, oh, not another hip hop movie or a ghetto story. The reason why it's called Life Moves is because like current events and people are going to be able to go to that film and identify with cast members because they're going through real life situations. Mm-hmm. And the actual premise of the movies is, how do these people navigate their life situations, find solutions, and keep it moving? So that's a lot different than the Breakin' movies because people have pigeonholed that genre with just breakdancing and that's it. But I've been outside of the box since then, and I'm very happy to say that we actually completed the movie. Mm-hmm. It's going to be premiering pretty soon. I'll send you the hashtags and the trailers. But yeah, check out Live Moves. How Yo-Yo got involved.
Yeah.
It's really interesting because if you think about it, Turbo and Ozone were part of the Fat Boys, Run DMC, the hip hop that was not gangster.
Right.
But in the 90s, you know, you had Tupac and you had Biggie. You had the whole, you know, Public Enemy. It was a whole different hip hop that came in. And yeah. we kind of got lost in translation mm-hmm. because the word hip hop became everything. But when Yo-Yo came up, it was real gangster and hardcore and Ice Cube and this and that. But the good thing is, upon our coming of age as mature adults and educators, we both decided to have a new image and give back to the entertainment community yeah. and maybe put something meaningful for people's children or people who have seen us in the 80s of how we used to be. Hopefully we're going to plant that seed so people know that she's different and I'm different, that we're not social militants, but we're trying to be humanitarians
yeah.
and use the music and the fashion and the hip hop to maybe encourage people to maybe, you know, make a difference in their lives. And so that's where her and I came in. Because that's, if you think about it, Turbo and Ozone and Yo-Yo and Ice Cube, that's like yeah. night and day in hip hop. But
right.
what we both did was we transformed like butterflies
mm-hmm.
and said, okay, that was the old us. Let's be mentors of this year and this new COVID age and this age of hostility and put something out there that lets people go, things that make you go,
Right? So, yeah, little Arsenio Katz right there.
We were talking about your talk show.
Yeah.
Hey, you were talking about your talk show. So on that theme, I'm glad that you allowed me on your show, which is a wonderful show, the FaceTime show. And I hope that investors or people who have productions and a little money to get it going, that you could take this show to the next level and you get a talk show. Hey, I could be your sidekick. You never know.
Thank you, man. Yeah, that would be kind of cool, man. Michael Chambers and Todd. Yeah, we'd have a lot of fun, man. I think we would have a lot of fun. I mean, that's what it's all about. And you have an amazing personality, bro. You got a lot of energy.
Thank you. Look at my nickname, Turbo.
And I'll be honest with you, man, I think your energy when getting to know you over the years is what made your dancing so unique back in the day. I think your personality is what exploded your talent, to be honest with you. And there are people like that, like a Forrest Whitaker is very quiet, but if you put him behind the camera, he comes out, right? And I think your personality came out in your dancing. But you're a great guy. Now, we're going to retract back if people don't know. Breakin was a huge impact on most people's lives. And I know it was a low-budget film. You had three unknown actors. And before you know it, you were competing, if not doing better in the box office than a movie like 16 Candles, which is pretty crazy. How was your camaraderie between your two cast members? That was obviously Ozone and Special K, and rest in peace, my man. And tell me about that film and how you guys came together to collaborate.
Well, this is interesting. You're the first person amongst a lot of people who've interviewed me, because this is the anniversary month of the movie. And I just got interviewed by some pretty well-known productions. The thing is this, think about this. In 1984, yeah, we were all unknown.
Yeah.
And everybody was jockeying for position to try to get their 15 minutes of fame. When I did that movie, I had barely turned 16 years old.
Yeah.
So the thing is, those two other cast members, they were already in their adult years, you know, approaching their 30s. So for me, I was one of those kids, you know, shut up and do your job. You know, don't get fresh. Don't get smart. I had a lot of Jewish mentors. You know, I mean, my studio teacher was Jewish. Most of the people who were agents and business people, they didn't care how cool your hair was or what gold chain was. It's like this: set etiquette, Hollywood, you got to be on, you know, don't be green. You do that. So, you know how it is. It was really tough to actually get a job. And if you were good enough, talent wasn't everything. They wanted to make sure that you were a professional seasoned artist. So I was receiving all this information, and I was very thankful being Black from the streets of LA to be in a film. So just on that merit, if I didn't do anything else at that time, I did what I could. I read my lines. If I couldn't get my lines, like I couldn't log on when you sent it, the thing is, I still said, okay, what can I do to save my job? And sure enough, the directors and everybody around, it was an all Israeli production, mind you. It wasn't Spike Lee. It wasn't some, you know, it wasn't some homie fraternity network production. Right. I had to prove myself as an artist once I got the audition. So with all that information, I was pretty much on my best behavior. Mm. And the directors and the production said, okay, you know what? These other people who are mouthing off, bye. We can get somebody to replace you. You can get fired really quick. Your dancers come a dime a dozen. So I shut up and I did my job. And sure enough, I got more respect from the production, from the director, Menachem Golan. I wasn't a schmoolik. The thing is, they were like, this little guy, not only is he talented, but he listens.
Yeah.
So with that being said, I was like a horse with blinders on a race. I didn't look to the left. I didn't do the right. When they said, okay, action, boom, I did my job. When they said, quiet on the set, I shut up. When they said, okay, you know what? Do your lines. I was really much on a tight ship with that. So it actually showed in the first movie. Mm-hmm. Because if you look at Turbo, Turbo was shy. Turbo was me because it was like a biography. But when it was time for me to dance, dude, I let off like lightning because that was my thing. And I wasn't really paying attention to what Lucinda and Shabadoo were doing because it was none of my business.
Right.
They were their own characters.
Correct.
So the more they focused on me, I was doing my best me, and it showed on film.
Yeah.
By the time the directors realized I was a moldable actor or a moldable hired cast member, because I wasn't Stanislavski, it's all dead. I won single, you know, Stella, Streetcar Named Desire. Stella! I was green. So what they did, they said, okay, how are we going to get this little guy to actually pull off his lines in the scene? So the writers and the directors came up with an interesting way to make the scenes real. They put us in scenarios. They said, okay, here's the scene setup. You're going to go to a Hollywood Beverly Hills socialite event and you're disrespected while you're trying to eat. How are you going to respond respectfully?
Right.
So these people are, oh, what do you do? I go, I'm one of those guys that, he's one of those guys that spins on his head. It was very subtle. I go, hey, how about some of this pig cheese? Or the other thing. The guy goes, hey, yeah, you know what? Guy throws a quarter. Why don't you come over and dance for us, boy? I just threw water at him. No. If you look at Breaking, I improvised my scene so well. I had people laughing because it was off page.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, there was no gender or racial thing there. It was very free, you know, the 80s. We didn't care what your sexual orientation was, or Black, white, ethnic, Albanian, you know, whatever. We just, love was the way, right? We were like the hip-hop free spirit beatniks. Oh, yeah, man. So I'm Venice Beach. Remember, I'm 16. I don't know really too much.
Yeah.
They go, okay, look, you're going to go to Venice Beach. Kelly's going to introduce you to this guy. And she's going to say his nickname. We need your reaction. I never knew anybody at the beach with ballet tights on. He wore ballet tights on at the beach. And I'm like, okay. So when he turned around, I was like, oh, okay. You know what? Cupcakes. I'm like, that's such a cute name. it's that scene in Ace Ventura, Jim Carrey. When he's pet detective, it's your boo-boo. It's your boo-boo. I had that. They're like, what are you gonna respond to when she says cupcakes? It's your boo-boo. So they realized, dang, we got a winner here. So if you look at some of the scenes, they were like, okay, let's set this up and see what Turbo's reaction was. And, you know, every single scene that people laughed at, it was all improv. That introduced me to improv comedy because it was scene setup, right? You know what? When I look back, a lot of people don't realize this, but other than dancing, the whole personality thing, the studio said, I went in as Boogaloo Shrimp. That was my Screen Actors Guild name, legal name. Yeah. I mean, I'm Screen Actors Guild, I am Boogaloo Shrimp. But when I came in there, they went, this guy's energy's turbocharged. So Turbo was really my real name because my dancing was more fast, you know, it was revved up. You know, everybody had to hold me back. So they go, this guy is definitely Turbo.
So that's I'm actually glad you brought that up. Where did you come up with the name Boogaloo Shrimp?
Now this is interesting. You ready? Yeah. Trivia. Let's go back. Remember, with the Beatles, remember the United Kingdom, the Beatles, Paul. Ringo Starr had a song called Back Off Boogaloo. James Brown had the Funky Boogaloo. Right. Boogaloo was a very big term in the 60s.
Yeah.
And matter of fact, it even goes further because a lot of the Boricuas, a lot of the Huevo, the Puertriqueños, they will testify and tell people the reason why the funky flavor with the New York City Breakers and Rocksteady, yo, the B-Boys, a lot of the people, even Baby Love from Rocksteady, she said, you know what? A lot of the Latinos were doing salsa, so right. The flavor, when they were top rocking, it was dale huevo, porica. And so the thing is, they go into the Afrocentric background of Boogaloo and the whole huevo thing. Celia Cruz said, Boogaloo, dale huevo. So it was a Latino thing. So, and then, matter of fact, I'm from Louisiana by way of Baton Rouge. So the thing is, for most people that don't know, the backstory of Forrest Gump, Forrest Gump's friend was Bubba Gump. My name is Shrimp, but my family's from the Bayou. They were Negroes that were mixed with French. And the thing is, there's Zydeco and the Cajun in the back, Bayou Boogaloo. In New Orleans, in the Adam Tyler, the water boy. Yes, he is.
Well, I'll be honest with you.
I was on the bayou, more down the bayou by way of Decatur.
I'm glad you cleared that up about your nickname. Seriously, I'm glad you cleared that up about your nickname, Boogaloo Shrimp. And I'm glad that you became a dancer because, to be honest with you, I don't think that nickname would work if you became a porn star. I'm just saying.
I could have got into the fishing industry. Hey, you want to go and catch a really good fish? You use Boogaloo Shrimp on your bait. I could have had a shrimp thing on by the boardwalk. Yeah.
Oh my God, man.
But listen, I'm glad that it has history in Latino roots and in music because Boogaloo is a big deal. And it even goes into Soul Train, you know, and even before Soul Train, I think right now, these days, I have a feeling everybody's searching for any kind of positivity to help inspire others. And for me, being an inner city child, you know, in the city, you know, hot child in the city, you know, so the thing is, I love the fact that my dance history and my roots can help inspire people when they know, hey, you know what, I got a little bit of Latino going on, a little bit of music ties to the Beatles, back off of you, you know, the boogie woogie boogaloo down Broadway. So the thing is, music, God has given us gifts with music, culture, diversity, and flavor for us to share, but also to share with the younger generation. So I'm hoping that even as we have fun, that my story will give more life to other people to share with their kids, you know, that we're all in this together, you know?
Yeah, and I love that. And I love the fact that your movie created a sequel, you know, which is weird, you know, Boogaloo, which is also Electric Boogaloo. And that was another great movie. I know Ice-T was in it as well. I believe he was one of the commentaries in the end. But to go forth on that, you got another big break, which is really cool because he's a huge icon in the music industry. You got to dance on the All Night Long tour with Lionel Richie, which is pretty crazy. How was it to work with such an amazing guy like that? Lead singer of the Commodores and now American Idol, and he's done so much. Tell me about that.
I have to be honest. Lionel's not a dancer.
No, so, not at all. He's a singer. No, no.
Here's where I'm going. This was interesting because that same firecracker personality, I was ready to rock and roll, man. And we had to wait the whole, it seemed like hours. I only danced one song on a 9-month world tour, but in the whole show, I had to wait because he had so many hit songs that were love ballads.
Yeah.
They weren't dance songs. So we would wait and wait and wait and wait and wait and wait. And they're like, okay, you know what? He's going to do All Night Long. All Night Long was the last show of the night. So that was a long time to wait to really, you know, crank it up, right? But the best thing about that,
yeah,
I got a really good internship in music because while those guys were doing their sound check and while he was playing, mm-hmm, I had all that time to listen to the music.
Yeah.
And he's a great songwriter.
Oh, yeah.
So I had no idea that I was getting music theory and all the production stuff. I mean, come on now. If you're with Lionel Richie and you're into music for 9 months, you're going to learn something.
Oh, yeah. I mean people forget. Remember, he was the co-writer in We Are the World with Michael Jackson and Quincy Jones. So
this is where I'm going with it. Ready?
Yeah.
So while I'm on the tour as just a dancer who only came out on one song, instead of twerking or going out to the clubs as I was 14, I did my show, I went shopping, I rested because I had to put 100% into that performance. Mm. And every single night, you know, every single night we were dancing somewhere because Lionel's tour, he had a private jet. When an artist of his magnitude has a private jet, they can book as many shows as they want and get in the city as many times as they want. So
right,
we were moving because it was a cash cow. He was trying to get as much money. So that meant I didn't really have a lot of time to sleep and twerk and hang. I had to work. So the thing is, I had to do a lot of resting because that was a grueling schedule for a 14-year-old. And the thing is, behind the scenes, this is where people miss me. They're like, oh, I know him. He's a breakdancer. No, you don't. When I was on Lionel Richie's tour before the movie Breaking, I learned a lot about music, but I got an opportunity to work with Michael Jackson because while we were dancing, doing his tour, Lionel behind the scenes was writing, "We Are the World.
Wow.
We are the children." He was writing "We Are the World" with Michael. So by the time we finished our tour, we're at the Universal Amphitheater in Los Angeles. And I mean, Lionel was like one of the biggest artists on the planet back then.
Yeah.
So when he came to Hollywood, all his Hollywood friends and Capitol Records, Warner, all the studios were there. So when we came out when we looked in the curtain to see who was in the audience, me and the other dancers were shocked. Stevie Nicks was there. A lot of A-listers were there. I'm telling you what, man, me and my friend, we didn't have a camera, but all those Hollywood socialites and everybody was there at his concert. And me and my friend Bruno, who was in Michael Jackson's videos and on tour with him, we kept seeing this weird looking black guy in the aisle. He was standing in the aisle and he looked like the Scarecrow from The Wizard of Oz. He had bad hygiene, he had buck teeth and a bow tie, and it was Michael. Michael was in the audience in disguise, like a transformer, right? Like a Negro transformer. Right there in the aisle, nobody knew it but us. That was how good his disguise was. And we were kids, so we were looking at him. He kept going, because he knew he didn't want us to blow it. We're going, it's him. So now I'm trying to give the best performance of my life because this is the first time he got a chance to see me perform, not teach him, but perform. So now I'm like, okay, now I'm dancing for for the man who's really the king of pop. So I'm like, okay, you know what? I get on that stage and I'm tearing it up. He comes backstage and everybody's going bananas. Ah, it's Michael, right? There's one picture, excuse me. There's one picture that is on file. It's somewhere. There's one picture that was released by Lionel Richie's manager at the time, King Cragen, where we took a picture. It's me, Shabadoo, Bruno, and Michael Jackson in disguise, because he didn't want anybody to have that picture because he spent a lot of money on his disguises. So if that had been leaked to the public, there goes another disguise. And he always liked to go out in public, but he didn't want to give it up at the time. So years went by and nobody ever knew who we were, who was really teaching him. All this mystery, because that's what helped him become the king of pop. It was always a mystery. He always had this sadistic look on his face, like, because he knew things other people didn't know, because his whole life was secrecy. Mm-hmm. Best thing about that, here we go. While I was doing all that stuff behind the scenes with him, I became Turbo and a pioneer of hip-hop art on my own with those. And matter of fact, each scene from what Cisco and Ebert and the press said, each scene that I soloed in, they likened me to a hip-hop version of Gene Kelly or Fred Astaire. Mm-hmm. So the thing is, that took me to another level on my own. Mr. Jackson, the stuff that I was able to teach him in solo private sessions helped him become a very good soloist with freestyle dance. So the thing is, there was so much going on. I'm so glad that I could look back and see how he took freestyle to the next level. Michael Jackson, when he practiced, he practiced and he perfected the art of freestyle popping. People don't, but it's other than his choreography. Choreography goes to Vince Patterson, Michael Peters, Jeffrey Daniels, Jeffrey Hornaday. Right. All those choreographers have credit. Mm-hmm. But people forget, in Michael's solo, he learned from Bob Fosse, Fred Astaire, Marcel, the French mime. Yeah. A lot of people, and the little bit that I was able to teach him, he was able to get the foundation of what it meant to be a street solo freestyle popper. And he didn't want to look like any guy on Venice Beach or in Washington Square Park, you know, or on Beach Street or Breakin. He was clever. Michael was able to interpret where it comes from, the popping, and make it his own, so he didn't look like any other dancers but himself. So if you look at, if you look at the Bad video, years after the early 80s, 87, now Michael's pop was from his chest. Because of that, he was still popping, but it didn't look like me or anybody else. People are like, well, he's snapping. He's still popping, right?
Yeah, he created his own style.
No. Then he got real smooth. He took the morphing and the real slow motion thing. He saw he did it. Very clever. There was nobody, not Mr. Wiggles, not the Electric Boogaloos, not me. Nobody could ever take credit for his style because it always came out his own way. So we just backed off and said, okay, look, you may have jammed with us, but you are definitely you. And so I will always praise his legacy as being a genius to be able to take from tap dancers, jazz, everything, and make his own style. Nobody ever jazz danced and tapped and then popped. Nobody ever did that. Yeah. But he was the one that did it. And so for me, Todd, to look back at that legacy and know that I had a small piece of being able to help somebody of that magnitude, it's really a beautiful blessing from God to see the young kids that were influenced by Michael. Yeah. A lot of performers, a lot of the best performers in music, the young guys, NSYNC, Usher, all of them, the ones who cite Michael, a lot of them never knew I actually worked with him because they never saw a name. It was never like, oh, well, where's the piece of paper? You know, I need some literature. Obviously, if you train with Bruce Lee, people should see, whoa, he learned from Bruce Lee, period. Enough said. If you train with somebody, they should see your style in that teacher. Yeah. Same with me. Michael trained with a lot of people, but my style my style resonates through his solos. And I love that because no matter all the lip service, all the literature, yeah. It's obviously, I don't dance like Jeffrey Daniels. My career on its own with my dance, there's an animated kind of style that Michael tried to harness. And right. You could see certain moves, he perfected it, and certain things he didn't really get a chance to continue his studies. Mm-hmm. You know, after the 90s, I mean, he was really not dancing. He was trying to, you know, get out of all of his court battles, whatever. And then anybody that's been through any kind of legal or personal problems in their life, I don't care how talented you are, you're not going to concentrate on your art.
Oh, so yeah, without a doubt. 100%. Yeah, yeah. So I wanted to go, since you're talking about pioneering and everything, and thank you for telling that story. I didn't know about that. I want to quickly want to do another thing you've been doing real quick. I know you're part of the Hip Hop Education Center, the founder of Martha Diaz, who I actually never had the pleasure. I know Martha is one of the associate curators and archivists for the Universal Hip Hop Museum. How did you get involved with hip hop and the story behind that real quickly and why you're doing that?
Well, what's really interesting, it started with Rock the Bells, much respect to LL Cool J and his platform. Mm-hmm. One of the things about LL Cool J's platform, Rock the Bells, he spotlights people that are mentors that are doing things for the community. So right. I was on there. They did a write-up on me and mm-hmm. my films and my legacy. So with that being said, that got attention because, I mean, come on. Rock the Bells, Cool Herc, New York City. I mean, that's the hip hop elements. I mean, those formats have helped push hip hop to an educated level around the world, beyond dance, beyond the turntables. There was more philosophy and more intellect behind all those topics. And so to be in that form took me from just a guy from Cali, I'm going back to Cali. I don't think so. It took me to another platform as an educator, right? So I am very humbled and honored to be validated by the Universal Hip Hop Museum because my first documentary film was directed and produced by director Taylor Galanka. He goes, Michael, if you don't ever do anything else in your life, he goes, I would love to at least document something of your other career highlights and put it out there in the universe and see if it gets noticed. And sure enough, once we had the Boogaloo Shrimp documentary, the Universal Hip Hop Museum allowed it in the museum as we donated it. And sure enough, as they reviewed it, it ended up in the Education Center. So for me, you know what? I'm really honored because I just found out that the Universal Hip Hop Museum is coming to LA. They're going to have a branch here. And they're going to have me speak on a panel with other people. I think there's going to be Master P, Ice Cube, some really big West Coast people. So, you know what? Whatever God's will, at the end of the day, if my legacy and other people can help these young people realize, okay, you know what? Create a job, work, do what you do, make money and pay some bills doing what you do, but love your neighbor, so be it, right? So that's how that came about.
Well, I love that, man. And first of all, Michael, thank you for being on FaceTime with Todd Wharton, brother. Your energy is crazy. I'm so honored. Brother, I'm so honored to develop a relationship with you over the years.
Todd, you're the man.
Thanks, man. Listen, I'm one of many. That's the way I look at it. I'm one of many good men.
Jimmy Kimmel, we need your TV show.
Thank you, man. I appreciate that. Yeah. And congratulations, by the way, on your new movie, Life Moves, with Yo-Yo Feelers. I'm looking forward to that. Hopefully I can get out there and see it. But, bro, your legacy, I think it's going to live on. You pioneering for other kids. You mentoring for other kids. You're one of the reasons why hip-hop dance is on the map. You're one of the reasons why there are great people in hip hop and all other cultures. And you're one of the reasons why Breakin became an iconic movie for all races and creeds because of the style that you brought, because of the personality you brought, and honestly, who you are. And more people should be like you. And thank you for being a guest on my show, brother. I appreciate you.
Thank you, Todd. And you know what? Big shout out to Rocksteady Normski. I apologize that we didn't get a chance to get together, but I really appreciate that you found Normski because people don't know this, but he was before Mr. Wiggles. and a lot of people popping John, all these people that were on YouTube. Normski is a pioneer from the movie Flashdance. Flashdance was before the movie Breakin and Beat Street. So the thing is, that gives respect to the kids that have paid dues all those years. And I've got to give a shout out to all the New York pioneers, just because, you know what? They all need respect. They all need to be in the limelight right now while hip hop is being right now. Breakdancing is announced in the Paris United Kingdom Olympics.
Yep.
So that's over there. But when it comes over here, I'm hoping that people will reach out to Powerful Pex, Ken Swift, Normski, all those people, you know, Rocksteady, all the survivors of that hip hop, so that they could all and their families eat if there's jobs or whatever provided. And so I'm from Cali validating them, Melly Mel, you know, all the Cool Herc's families, you know, Studio 54, the Roxy, the Boogie Down Bronx, the Webble, the NoHo District. You know, I got love for all you guys, you know, and I'm hoping that God will bless in this COVID time everybody with some sort of work, but we all are in this together, you know.
Well, I think based on that, shout out to everybody, especially to Normski. I had him on the show. There you go, brother. Shout out to the whole entire family from the East and West Coast. Love is love. Hip hop is hip hop, but all cultures coming together. That's what this is all about.
So guys, this is
my dude right here.
Shakish.
That's right. This is my man. This is my man, Michael Chambers.
Caught in the house.
Thank you, brother. I'll see you in a bit. So, Michael, again, thanks for being a guest on FaceTime with Todd Wharton. Thank you for your longtime friendship, and thank you for all the positive energy you brought to all cultures through your dance steps and your moves and your positive energy. And guys, if you don't know, check out my man Michael as Turbo in the movies Breakin 1 and Breakin 2, Electric Boogaloo. It's made an impact on the world. It's going to make an impact on you as well. And guys, I hope you enjoyed this interview. I know I did. Especially interviewing a friend like Michael. But until the next time, if you're not living a passionate life, then whose life are you living? I'll see you soon. Take care.
He is the most interesting man in the world.
I'm not always on YouTube, but when I am, I make sure I'm subscribed to FaceTime with Todd Wharton. Be thirsty, my friends.